Welcome to The Plain Truth, the show where we go into some of the mysteries, anomalies, and the dirty underbelly of the world around us. I'm your host, Paul, and joining us this week, we have Anthony Miguels, who is a writer on that very, very important of the bankster dictatorship and usury. Anthony, are you there?
Good afternoon, Paul. If it's afternoon for you guys, I think it's maybe morning there.
Well, here I am in Asia, so it's even a difference. So it's pushing midnight for me. But
Good evening then, Paul.
But thanks for coming. And could you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yes, I'm Anthony Michels. I'm 42, live in the Netherlands in Arnhem, and I'm a monetary reformer. I write a lot about monetary reform on Facebook and especially on my website, realcurrencies.wordpress.com. And I'm also involved in creating currencies. So I have designed a certain monetary architecture with which people can implement their own currencies with a very high-class monetary architecture so that they can use create local currencies, etc. And I'm creating a national currency here in Holland with a number of colleagues. That is to say, a privately controlled currency that will circulate in the Netherlands, and this will hopefully be launched in the spring of this year.
Sounds very interesting, and so I hope our listeners can go check out your website and see that you've been working, what you've been working on. And joining us for the show, a couple of my friends, Jerry.
Hey, welcome back, Anthony.
Hi, Jerry.
And Gary.
Hi, Anthony. I'm very pleased to be talking with you today.
Hello, Gary.
Well, Anthony, let's get to the heart of the matter. There's all kinds of economic stuff going on in Europe. So why don't we today we want to talk about basically this push for transnational or global currencies, and where better to start than the euro, how that came to be and what's going on in Europe. So open the floor to you. What do you want to say? Where did the euro come from and where is it going?
Yeah, that's of course a broad question because you can. That depends on how far back you want to go, but maybe it's good to just rehash a little bit of 20th century history that led to the creation of the European Union and ultimately the euro, and so that we can get a better view of where we're heading and what the agenda behind all these crises that we're facing, what the agenda behind them is, and. Because, you know, in the 20th century, basically began with the First World War. And at the time, you had a really fin de siècle kind of atmosphere in Europe. And everybody sensed that at some level, there was an end of an era. And what basically had been going on is that in the decades before that, that Germany had been united in 1871. And... since then, it had been really dominating the continent, and this was really a very natural process. It was simply because Germany had by far the largest population at the time. It had about, you know, maybe 70 million people, whereas France and Britain had perhaps maybe 40 million. And Germany was also very centrally located in Europe. So, and this is just basically from a networking point of view, a very both vulnerable because you can be encircled, as it indeed happened, but also a very powerful position because all roads between East and West go through Germany, and this means that Germany is really pivotal in connecting Eastern Europe and Western Europe and the different kind of attitudes and mindsets and spirituality that that in both areas of Europe and indeed the world was manifest at the time. And at the East you had Russia as the great power, and Eastern Europe and Russian Orthodoxy there as its form of Christianity, and until 1917, of course, still despotism, which was also the case in Germany, where an autocratic regime under the emperor was leading the pack, or leading the country. And in the West, you have a materialist kind of society, heavily focused on science and already losing its religious roots, disconnecting from Christianity, and heavily industrialized. And And this force field, Germany was really industrializing, uniting, and starting to dominate the continent. And without the First World War, you know, nowadays historians agree that purely economically and industrially, Germany would have dominated the continent within maybe even a decade only. And from there, you would probably have seen some sort of development of a German-led European Union, which would have almost been unavoidable. You had Austria-Hungary was a very brittle empire and completely dominated by Germany, and France was simply not big enough anymore. Simply lacked the clout to really compete with Germany, and Britain. Well, Britain was, of course, very much focused on its empire and its American relations, more part of the West. But the continent really was coming together under this German hegemony. And that is really what the First World War and indeed also the Second World War was about. It was about destroying this this German nationalism and a German-led unification of Europe. And it had everything to do with playing out against each other, Western powers and Germany, because I think this process probably could have been completed in a peaceful manner and in a manner that should have been acceptable to the other countries. Although, of course, it would never have been completely comfortable because Germany would have been very dominant, but. And this is what happened. And then there came the First World War, and this war was basically won by the West, but it did not really break German power. And the same sort of trend would have been unavoidable in the longer term also. And then you had the Second World War, and that really destroyed Germany as the dominating power in Europe. And it also created this huge trauma and. This really never again kind of attitude, not just with the Jews, they talk a lot about never again, but very much also for the population of Europe, because especially the Second World War, but also the First, had really been very devastating and also so very senseless, because the slaughter in the First World War, the guys going over the top and just being mowed down, and later in Eastern Europe, this incredibly catastrophic war between Germany and Russia that really had a profound impression on the human psyche. And so the European Union, not really as a no longer so much as a German-led power, but this time more from basically the London city and from the banking cartel that is situated there. They started their own European Union project with the story of the European Union will unite Europe and it will end wars in Europe, and we have suffered so much, but now we must unite and we will have peace and prosperity. And that was basically the storyline at the time and the geopolitical context with which in which all this is this was embedded. And Europe has really been built from the day one. The European Union, anyway, from a problem-reaction-solution kind of mechanism, and the war itself, the two wars themselves were already the beginning of that, creating these wars and then creating the solution for them. But later in the European Union's history, it was all about creating facts on the ground. This is how Monnet, which is the great strategist of the European Union, how he called it, he would just create facts on the ground. Problems that would then have to be solved by the by Brussels and by further cooperation and European solutions for European problems. That basically the story, and that's what we still have today. Because now, let me put it this way: this was also the rationale behind the implementation of the euro. Because already at the time of the implementation of the euro, at the Maastricht Treaty. The more sensible economists, and okay, there are a few of these, but the few that were, you know, willing to speak about
all three of them,
all three of them exactly. But you know, if you had a basic grasp of what a monetary union would do, it was already very clear from the outset that there were huge differences in competitiveness of the converging economies. And okay, you know, you had this time period where the economies were indeed converging, and where they were basically disciplined by high interest rates from Germany, which was unifying at the time. So the German economy and the German interest rates were basically setting the pace for the entire European economy with very mixed results. But this led to some sort of harmonization, and there were agreements about, you know, your deficit can be no more than 3%, and you can have no more than 60% of national debt, and targets like these. And these were more or less met, but still, when the European Union nations joined in the euro, it was really a very diverse bunch, and basically you had the north-south axis, which is the basic dynamic of today, also was already very much in place. Germany and Northern Europe were far more competitive than the south, and it was very clear that without the possibility for the south to devalue, their economies would simply face a structural deficit on their balance of payments with the North, and that they would be leaking euros to the North and therefore would face deflationary pressures in their own economies, because they're simply leaking, the means of exchange is leaking upwards, leaking up north, and therefore less and less euros are available in the south. They have to lend, to borrow to replenish the money supply, but then of course you have higher debt and higher interest payments and all the problems of these. So that is indeed what transpired, and this was just another example of the problem-reaction-solution, because the goal has always been to create a huge, monstrous European superstate, and the euro was a means to an end. The idea was, we create the euro, we create these disbalances, we will have a euro crisis, and then we can strong arm the nations to surrender budget sovereignty to Brussels, which is the final frontier for such a superstate. Because, you know, if Brussels wants to rule Europe, then obviously they will have to control the budgets of the nations. And that's really what's at stake in this euro crisis. So,
Can we go back a couple seconds just to get your take on it? So would you argue that basically there was kind of a fight between a City of London version of an EU and a more Germanic version of an EU? They both wanted a greater integrated Europe, but it's just a question of who would have the relative dominance.
Well, I think that the City was already dominating Europe behind the scenes, even with the ascent of Germany. But they used the rise of Germany on a national level to create these tensions. And in the 19th century, because in 1914, you had these two alliances that were locked in this stalemate. You had the Entente of the West, Britain and France, and you had Russia, which was cooperating with the West because of the German threat. And then in the center you had Germany and Austria-Hungary at the time still. And this had been created over decades during the 19th century with endless diplomacy, very much dominated behind the scenes by Rothschild, and particularly Rothschild at the time. And so it's more like, you know, Rothschild and his buddies, they basically wanted to prevent a German domination of the continent, and they used the rise of Germany, which was very natural because of the huge German population in the center of the continent. They basically used that to create the tensions for the First World War, which was very much their project.
Yeah, well, that makes perfect sense. Would you say that the way the wars came down were the way that the Rothschilds or the City of London wanted them to go?
Yeah, very much so. Absolutely. Yeah. No, it was a resounding success from the perspective of the banking cartel. Both wars. In the First World War, there was this this German defeat, and it was very tense, because this is often underestimated by people in the West. But Germany was pretty much dominating in the war. It was really until the American GIs came into the battlefield in March 1918 that really tipped the scales. But the pressure on the West on the Western powers was huge, and France was basically in the ropes. And cut to pieces and at the end of their resources. But then, you know, it was really the entrance of America in the war, which was, yeah, there are many conspiracy theories, of course, about how that happened, the Jewish involvement in and the Colonel Mendelhaus, of course, very much mentioned often as together with his protege Wilson, Woodrow Wilson, getting America in the war. But that was a very tense situation, but they ultimately overcame and they won and they destroyed the German army. And especially they didn't really destroy the German army, but they dominated economically ultimately. And then in the Second World War, that was just basically the second chapter, the second installment of the same struggle. And that was a complete victory for the banking cartel with the destruction of Germany. And, you know, Germany lost a great deal of its population, huge swathes of land, especially in Eastern Europe. And Prussia, for instance, a lot of what was classically Prussia was given to Poland, etc. And Germany was by far no longer so domineering anymore in the continent. And of course, you had the United Nations, you had the consolidation of communism, communism ruling Eastern Europe, which was what the bankers wanted at the time to create this to set the stage for the Cold War. That was for that they needed the Soviet Union to dominate in the Eastern Europe. And of course, it really destroyed all opposition to banking, because this is a very important trend also. In the 20s and 30s, there was huge debate about monetary reform in throughout the Dominions and in Europe itself. And awareness of monetary matters and awareness of the banking cartel was much more astute than we have today. Okay, today you have this huge growing awareness, so, you know, we're really catching up quickly nowadays, but at the time it was really very common for people to talk about monetary reform and how crucial it was to the whole human condition. And this was really shut up after the war. It was after that monetary reform became anti-Semitic and communism as the faux opposition against capitalism was very much entrenched and accepted. And yeah. That was also a very important result of this of these wars, and all in all, it was just a total mind-blowing success for the money power.
Well, you could make a good case for that. I think there is an alternative theory, though, that I'd like to hear your take on, because I I read a lot of Russian stuff, and I over the years have come to think there's a reasonable case for it, and that is that. Actually, as you know, the Western bankers and the German, you know, military and so on installed the Bolsheviks, basically, or helped them. Let's say that the Tsar's army staff changed sides, and so it's much more complicated than that. But let's just say that to a large degree, the Bolsheviks were, you know, agents of the Western banking crowd.
Absolutely.
And then in the mid-30s, Stalin purged and killed them as best as he could. Trotsky, there's even in the last 20 years, the Russians have released a tremendous amount of stuff from their archives. There's even a letter one of the spies had that the Western banksters had agreed, Trotsky had agreed, they were going to have this war in Eastern Europe, but they'd already agreed on what the result would be. Germany would get the Ukraine was the biggest thing from a Soviet point of view. And the end result was going to be the EU, which at least from the position that was presented to the Soviet, you know, spies or whatever, agents of the West, that was the actual goal. And that both Russia and Germany would be hurt. But in the end, the victory would be a German victory. But once Stalin started smashing all the Zionists and the Western agents, then the war became a much more, you know, fight to the bitter end kind of thing. And I think there's a case for that. I think that they wanted an EU, and it was a question, you know, things are negotiable. I guess what I'm trying to say is I think they have a plan A, a plan B, a plan C.
Oh, very much so. Yeah, definitely.
And
so,
for example, if you look at Syria, yeah. not trying to interrupt mm-hmm. there, but if you look at Syria, I think they're already on plan C
here, yeah.
or plan D.
Yeah, definitely.
I think that
yeah.
possibly, you know, a lot of people look at it like, you know, the result of World War II was decided in, you know, 1925 at some, you know, Bilderberg meeting before Bilderberg. And I'm not sure if that's the case. Anyway, I would just ask listeners to look into this. There's a strong case to be made.
Yeah,
that,
because when Stalin
you know, violently went out against the Zionists and the Western agents and killed thousands of them, expelled tens of thousands. And I think that's how you go from being Time's Man of the Year to being the new Hitler, which, of course, is the joke, because I'm just trying to say it's a little bit more complicated. In other words, these banksters use individuals and countries, and they use the Germans, and they also use the Russians, of course, is all I'm trying to say. But anyway, just for something, you know, for listeners to look into. But anyway, the results were what they were. Half of Europe was destroyed.
Let me respond a little bit to this, because what you're saying is very interesting. And, you know, I think it's quite clear that under Stalin there was some sort of a national reaction to the origins of Bolshevism, because you know, the early stages of Bolshevism were very much dominated by Jews and by basically internationalist forces, and Jews, of course, by definition are pretty internationalist. And under Stalin there was some sort of a Russian reaction or a nationalist reaction, and what was very much clear was that Stalin decided that Bolshevism had to be consolidated in Russia, and that he at that point gave up on internationalizing the revolution. And and this was a great upset to the bankers, and basically Trotsky was their man, and Trotsky was a really internationalist communist who wanted to export the revolution from Russia. And yeah, he was sidelined and ultimately killed by Stalin, of course. And Stalin did indeed murder a lot of the old cadres, who, you know, nobody can blame him for that, because they were all animals. And although plenty of them still remained in positions, and Stalin also murdered millions of ordinary Russians and Ukrainian so-called kulaks, who were simply peasants, of course. So, you know, it's a very mixed picture. But there was definitely, after Stalin's installation and consolidation of power, the bankers really cooled on Russia and at least partly lost control, and then started using Hitler to menace Stalin. That's pretty much in accordance with what you were saying, eh?
Yeah, and I'm also going to argue that the bankers managed to influence the Nazis more. They got in shocked, Hjalmar shocked.
Exactly, yeah.
Right. I mean, the more anti-bankster elements in Germany were, I think, driven out to some extent. But, you know, definitely. You're the expert on this. You can comment on that. But I just think that people get an overt simplification of things. They hear that this guy was this or that. And I'm just saying it's a much more complicated story when you're dealing with political parties and countries. And they might even change based on their own interests. I mean, was Saddam Hussein America's golden boy, or was he our enemy number one?
Yeah, you know, but that these people simply use a person for some or a party or an idea for some for a while, and then they start dumping on it, or vice versa. You know, to them it's basically all the same. And
the ends justify the means.
Exactly. So yeah, and they're great tacticians. On a tactical level, they're real opportunists, and they just go with the flow and with whatever opportunity arises, and that's how they operate.
Anthony, they have another advantage, I think, is that even if somebody becomes an enemy, like let's say Stalin, they know that Stalin is only one guy, and he's not going to live forever. And in that case, I think they killed him. And then there was like a 3-year civil war in Russia or in the Soviet Union when Stalin died. And then the bankster Western guys won that fight. So my point is, they know that they can outlast their opposition, basically.
Yeah.
That's one of their real advantages, because they always have money on their side. They can always buy everybody.
Yes,
but anyway, why don't we go? Okay, so now we've kind of set up how we got to World War II, the post World War II kind of environment.
Yeah.
How did the euro start to come into it?
Well, you know, the euro had been under discussion for many years before it was ultimately agreed upon in the Maastricht Treaty, and you know, they were already gravitating towards each other, and they had the EQ, the ECU at the time, which was used as a unit of account, which is a secondary function of money. So the euro was not yet used as a means of exchange, but at least they were accounting in the EQ. ECU, and this was the prelude to the euro, and then ultimately, I think in 2002 or so, the consumers started to pay with the euro, and yeah, like I said, it was basically they first basically what they wanted always was a political union, but European integration was of course a very complicated project because, well, you know, it's really, these countries, okay, they want to cooperate, but they don't want to give up their sovereignty, yeah? And they just don't. And these governments have, even though they're very much under control of the bankers in many respects, selling it to the populace and getting all the several different interest groups in the nations, getting them on board for such a project and then herding them into this direction is of course, very complicated a process. Especially if it's all based on lies, and
bankers are good at that.
They are good at that,
and politicians aren't too bad either.
Exactly, and they use cool calculation and a huge bluff and. And that's what they do. But ultimately, the political process was stalling, and they tried to ram through the euro and to create this problem with the euro crisis. I think that was very much on the agenda at the time already. And the euro was simply the main idea of implementing the euro before there was political union was exactly to force this political union. And that's also very much. That is exactly the dynamic that is driving everything in Europe today still, because this is the great struggle. The ECB and the European Union and the manipulators from behind the scenes, they are trying to force the Germans and all the other nations to surrender this budget sovereignty to Brussels. And that's what it's all about. And this is the key goal of the euro.
Well... getting into kind of the last 10, 15 years, I mean, when did the euro become the only game in town, so to speak?
I think it was 1999 that big business and governments in between them started paying with the euro, and that in 2002 that it was the national currencies were replaced with the euro for consumers and day-to-day transactions and day-to-day economy.
And, I mean, you're a European, and so you're going to know a lot better than I am. But my view is when I would meet Europeans traveling or wherever, 10, 15, 20 years ago, they tended to be pro-EU and pro-Euro.
Yeah,
and I don't see that. And I don't see that anymore.
Very much so, yeah. Yeah.
That's am I wrong? Nice. What has happened?
No. Well, you know, what has happened is that that there is a huge power grab and by Brussels. For instance, most of the domestic laws these days are just hammered through national parliaments, but the decision for them has already been made in Brussels, and all this legislation comes from Brussels. And this legislation is often very much out of touch, and you have this eurocratic regime in Brussels, and it's totally out of control in the sense that it absolutely does not care for for local tradition, for local interests. It is simply out of touch, and it's very much pro big business. And in Brussels, you have all these big lobbies, just as you have in Washington. You have all these major corporations in Brussels, and they are lobbying all the players there, and. So with all the accompanying corruption that entails, and then you have of course mass immigration, which is also very much an EU project and very much starting to bother more and more people in Europe, and this has been an ongoing trend and over many years now. And then when the euro came, and this is a very very clear fact also, although people still don't want to face it really, but living standards have been really plummeting since the euro was implemented. In for instance, in Holland, the statistics are that between 2002 and 2009, prices doubled, and wages rose only 25%. So that's really a huge decline in living standards, and exacerbating already an already very negative situation, because living standards have been declining in the West for normal people for decades now. But since the euro was implemented, it really started to gain pace, and then we finally got into the euro crisis or the credit crunch globally in 2008, and since then, of course, it has only gotten much worse. And so I think that both mass immigration and the crunch and the out of touch politics in Brussels and the complete lack of democracy there, because the European Parliament is just, I think you may be aware that the way the EU is organized is exactly the same way as the Soviet Union is organized, and the EU commissars are basically the Politburo, and the European Parliament is just as the Soviet Parliament is just to applaud the decisions of the Politburo. And it's completely untransparent who behind the scenes puts these people there in the European Commission. And so these factors really have eroded all the support for the European project in Europe.
Yes. It's kind of like an even more extreme version of the Soviet system.
Absolutely.
They at least had, 10% of the population in the party and doing stuff. 10% of Europeans are not, in the European system, so to speak. It's just totally driven by inside. Not that the Soviet system was any good. It was terrible. But I'm just saying it's even less. It's like instead of 10%, it's 0.1% of the people making the decisions.
Yeah,
or something.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So basically what's happened is just a total collapse of legitimacy, right? I mean,
that's really very much the case. Well put. That's that's what I see constantly, and it really was brought home, I think, to the European Union when in 2005 the Dutch and the French rejected the constitution in these referenda that were held there, 60% in Holland and 50%, which was really very surprising because Holland has always been very strongly pro EU. And 55% against in France, and they never bothered asking again, and they redid the whole thing in Lisbon, but then decided not to call it a constitution, but in effect it still is. But that really destroyed all the legitimacy that the EU really has.
Yeah, I mean, they can talk about they don't like some country some other part of the world, wherever it may be. It could be the Ukraine, it could be Libya or Syria. They say it's not democratic. That's a joke, right?
Totally.
The EU is totally undemocratic. Well, okay, so maybe now we can get closer to today. We've now got Syriza in Greece and all kinds of things going on in Europe. Demonstrations in France. What do you see in the more modern context of what's going on?
Well, there's definitely huge popular unrest, and this will continue to gain momentum in the coming years. In the West, it's all about mass immigration. That's really the key factor. You see this in with UKIP and with Le Pen's platform and Geert Wilders, of course. And that's a big issue there. In Greece and in the south of Europe, it's also very much the economy, of course, and which is to a lesser extent, to only slightly lesser extent in the north, also very much the case. But obviously, the south has suffered most from the euro crisis. And in Greece, of course, this what has happened to Greece is simply an unbelievable disgrace and terrifying. What kind of insane banker tyranny and also troika tyranny with this insane ghoulish austerity that has been forced on the Greece on the Greeks, which is a completely irrelevant kind of policies, which only leads to further depression, further deflation. It's we have known forever. Any decent economist knows that you cannot in a depression like this, force austerity and then hope that that there will be economic growth, because the austerity only worsens the deflation, which is causing the depression. So this is really ghoulish what they have done to the Greeks, and they have lost about 30%, maybe even more, of their output, and wages have been slashed, pensions have vaporized.
Anthony, what is it? Is it sadism? Is it what is the? Why are they taking such a hard line in a way that can't possibly work?
Yeah, that's a good question.
What is motivating them? Because, yeah. I mean, this is the other thing. I mean, the EU has been doing aggressively stuff like the destruction of Eastern Europe, the depopulation in, you know, the Baltic states, the destruction of Bulgaria, Greece, right? They're intentionally choosing policies that are to lay waste to these areas. Why?
Yeah, it's hard to fathom, but I think it's to a huge extent driven by that they simply can get away with it, because you see more popular unrest, but considering what they have been up to and how insane and ghoulish it all is, and the fact that that a few people really gain a lot from it too, you know, it's not that everybody suffers. No, it's just a huge wealth transfer. It's all highway robbery, and the passiveness of people, that they simply accept this. Yeah. So maybe the question is, why not?
Okay, that's fair, but I being a conspiracy theorist, have to think there's a little bit more to it.
I think,
for example, in the case of Eastern Europe, by laying waste to it, you prevent Russia from ever, you know, getting back in the game, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I think that's part of it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I think they're setting an example. I think, you know, Greece is really small, right?
Yeah.
And so basically, they can throw Greece out of the European Union. It doesn't matter. It's to set an example for Spain or Portugal or something, I suppose. But anyway,
well, kicking Greece out of the European Union, I wouldn't take to talk too lightheartedly about that, because that will always be a big defeat for them. Because it sets a precedent.
Yeah, I know. Anyway, that's why I'm kind of asking.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, what do you see with Syriza then? What do you think in this current situation in Greece?
Yeah, well, you know, adding to what you were saying, you know, that there is a deeper reason for this. I think it's also about creating the distress in the population, and then providing them with the solution. And there's also simply the classical dialectic, creating all these horrible problems, huge wealth inequality and the destruction that you were just describing. And then implementing communism, and I think Syriza is very much a part of that, because that's really a very strongly left-wing kind of outfit with a lot of Maoist, communist kind of background of many of its people and its political platform also, you know. So Marxism obviously is the organized opposition against capitalism, and So, you know, if you're saying, why are they doing this, it's also setting the stage to create communism. And I think that Syriza is very much a part of this.
Well, that's interesting. We'll have to see what they do. But I mean, looking at if it's true, what you see on the internet of their supposed 40 planks in their platform, I don't see how the EU could be happy with them. You know, leave NATO, for example, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Now, maybe from a longer-term point of view, we get into this other theory that you have, and many do, and I think there's a lot of evidence for it, is that the banksters actually want to take down the U.S.
Yes.
And within the context of that, maybe a European army is rational. I don't know, but this is all just speculation. But I'm just saying, when I look at the planks that Syriza claims to support, I don't think the EU is going to be happy with a number of them.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, I can go along with the idea that generally, you know, Marxism or whatever, they can be happy with. Yeah, go ahead.
If I could just jump in, why doesn't Syriza just come out and say, you know, we're going to default on the debt? They're it seems to me they're kind of waffling. They're saying, you know, we still want to stay in the EU. And, you know, why don't they just do what Iceland did, default, take the pain for a couple of years? I mean, they're already in a lot of misery right now. And after those, you know, two or three hard years, they're going to come out of it a hell of a lot better. And one more thing I should point out is I just read an article the other day that George Soros is actually behind some of the funding of Syriza. So if that's true, you know, that's pretty much all we have to know.
Yeah, you know, that's very much on target, of course, because what it's all about, we're now talking about what we're seeing, but we should also talk very much about what we're not seeing. And what we're not seeing is a real populist response concerning banking. And you were mentioning Iceland, and Iceland would already be much better an example for Greece than Marxism. But we could even go a step further and say, why not just reform the monetary system? And you know, Greece has been destroyed by banks. Now let Greece start destroying some of these banks.
Well, okay, but
that's absolutely what we're not hearing. And
if I can interrupt, okay, but Anthony, I mean, it's not for me to try to defend them. I'm just saying, in their 40 planks, one of them is nationalize all banks.
Yeah, okay, but then you have public banks, and this is typical of Marxism.
Well, I mean, I agree, but I mean, I just, if you know anything about Greece, I mean, it's like, I don't know how to put it, but the country is basically like one third communist, one third fascist,
Of course,
and one third in the middle. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, the politics in Greece are such that communism is going to be the only, you know what I mean? It was either going to go a right wing anti-system, which would have been the Golden Dawn, right? And then a number of their guys were arrested. They were, you know what I mean? There was a clampdown on them. And I'm not saying that was right. I'm just saying that's what happened, right? Mm-hmm. So it left the public no choice. A totally discredited mainstream or, you know, essentially younger communists. And the people went with younger communists.
Yeah.
And I totally agree with you. But, I mean, they just have only been in a few days. I mean, we'll have to see what they claim to want to do over the next, you know, 3 weeks or 3 months.
I
personally don't have great hope, but I think they couldn't be as bad as what's been done. They've been totally destroyed. Greece has just been beat up badly and left on the side of the road.
Unbelievable. Yeah, yeah. But it's terrible what they did to Greece. So the response itself is understandable, but I think that we really need to be very clear that we're seeing a typical dialectical process here, which we have seen many times in Latin America. You have also all these neo-Marxist kind of outfits that are controlling these countries with all the devastating effects for the economies there. And also, by the way, the supranational aspect of Marxism there, because these guys are building a Latin American Union. And we will really have to see how anti-EU this Syriza outfit is really going to show to be. But as long as we don't put monetary reform squarely at the center of the agenda, we will still be fairly comfortable in saying that things are going still pretty much as the bankers intend. And as long as people don't start looking at the banks and really reforming the monetary system, then not much is going to change.
It sort of begs the question. I mean, How did Greece get so far indebted? I mean, despite what people think, these bankers are not stupid. You know, sometimes they play up that angle like they're incompetent or whatever, but these guys are pretty sharp when it comes to money. And from my perspective, I mean, it seems to me that they knew that Greece would never be able to pay back this money.
Of course.
So if they knew that, then it would seem to imply that the goal all along was to get them, you know, so far into debt that they'd be able to buy up the whole economy for pennies on the dollar.
Yeah, of course, definitely. Yeah, I mean, that's going on all over the globe, and Greece is only a bad example. But what you see everywhere over the last 6 years in this after the so-called depression, which is, as we know, still ongoing, that debt income ratios have been deteriorating all over the board, and incomes have declined or only risen nominally, while debt has exploded, national debt but also private debt. And this is not just in Greece, but it's in China, in Japan, in America, and in the rest of Europe, so basically the entire developed world. And that is what the bankers want. I mean, they want more debt, they want more interest payments, and a larger part of our income going to debt service. That's exactly what they want. And that's very much part of the agenda. And they are creating this global depression and this global deflationary debt trap because they were because of all the concessions that they will be able to force from us in alleviating the debt. And for the time being, they're simply upping the ante. And they're indeed not stupid. This is their business. This is what they do. Get people into debt slavery and then force them to do things.
Yeah, so essentially it boils down to the old Hegelian dialectic or problem reaction solution, as people like David Icke call it. So they're essentially going to create so much pain that we're probably going to go to them, you know, on our hands and knees, begging them for the solution that they want to apply anyhow.
Absolutely. That's what's going on. And in Europe, then, like we were discussing, in Europe, very much on the agenda is the surrender of budget sovereignty. And that's a great struggle in Europe. And they have been hurting Southern Europe to create the and also France, because, you know, it's France is, of course, the main issue ultimately. That's the agenda in Europe, that is, because the basic thing that is going on, the deflationary debt trap, is everywhere. But in China, they have a different agenda than in Japan and in America and in Europe, of course. But in Europe, the further integration in the European Union is the goal.
So one other question, Anthony, if Greece defaults on their debt, do you think that we're going to see other countries like Portugal or Spain follow suit?
The bankers are not so much averse against writing off some debts if needs be. So maybe we will see some write-offs left and right. But for the time being, I don't really expect it. And I think that if Greece is really going to default on the debt, then that would be very interesting, but for the time being, I'm not really too sure if that's going to happen. But if they do it, they will probably be forced to pay a very heavy price, because obviously they don't want other countries to follow suit.
What about some of the things I'm reading is essentially saying that Russia might bail out the Greek economy. Do you have any opinions on that? Do you think that's a possibility? And if it is a possibility, is it any better than what they're in right now?
Yeah, that's a good question also, of course. I think it's a possibility. If Russia sees practical chances there, then why not? You know, it depends on how much it will cost. But, can Greece go into the Russian camp? Yeah, it's possible, I think. Yeah, why not? Yeah.
I think there's essentially, I don't know if you've read about the Russian pipeline deals that they're trying to build. I guess they're being blocked with the South Stream in Europe by the EU. So they're building an alternate route down through Turkey. And I think if they could get Greece on board, that would be a huge win for them.
Definitely, although it will also be tricky with the Turkish and Greek tensions that are classical. So it will be difficult to get these both on board. But you know, if they can gain influence there, then and indeed also for pipelines, which is very much there, also part of the momentum, especially with all the gas in the Mediterranean Sea, etc. So
Well, I think if you want to talk about Greece, you also need to bring in Cyprus. There's a strong case that the banking bail-in in Cyprus was an attack on Russia by the EU, because that's where Russia did a lot of its banking. Gazprom had their bank there and so on. And it was a backdoor into the EU, so to speak, for Russia and Russians. And notice the bail-ins didn't happen anywhere else, only in Cyprus. And the banking
Not yet, huh?
Yeah, but I mean, but the point is, what I'm trying to say is it was totally a selectively done thing.
Well, for the time being, but bail-ins will be the norm in the next round.
I'm with you, but I'm just saying it was done at that point in that time as an attack on Russia.
Yeah.
And there's gas off of Cyprus.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, pipelines are going to be coming from Turkey, most likely.
And there's, you know, Iran, there's, you know, the Caspian, there's Russia, and there's the Mediterranean. And, you know, so there's, I guess what I'm trying to say is Cyprus is part of Greece, really. If Greece goes, mm-hmm. you're looking at Cyprus probably going as well. Anyway, there definitely there's a gas issue in all this, Jerry.
I agree.
And that could bring a lot of extra money. And, well, let's face it, I mean, the control of that gas is vital. It's not even just the money. It's that Europe can't function without the gas.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, well, that's, of course, huge leverage that that Russia has. And it's you know, we're talking about Turkey already, but Turkey has signed a huge energy deal with Russia also a few months ago. And especially since Russia took over the Crimea in last year, that was a huge strategic victory, of course, for the Russians, because they consolidated their outlet in the Black Sea, their naval base. And Turkey, I think Turkey really acknowledged this strategic situation with this gas deal. And I think that momentum is really moving in the Russian direction in that area. So it's not far-fetched. If the Greeks really have get a problem with the European Union, that they could go to Moscow for some backing.
Well, they have historical friendship. There's a lot of, you know, the religion. There are a lot of things there.
Mm-hmm.
And if Greece defaults, just says, you know, we're going bankrupt, gets thrown out of the EU, then, you know, Russia can help them and not pay the debts.
Right? Yeah.
And so there's some economic logic. We'll have to see, but that's certainly a possibility. And then don't forget the Russian deals with China mean that in about, what, 3 years or so, Russia will be able, 4 years or so, to start selling the gas to China instead of to Europe if mm-hmm. Europe continues, you know, with a fairly hostile stand. So there's a lot of geopolitics going on, too, setting aside that. But from a more banking point of view, there's no question that the powers that be could have attacked Syriza more. And so you do wonder if they don't have a certain degree of control, like Jerry mentioned, maybe Soros money or whatever. I'm sure they've got mm-hmm. dubious money behind them, because all money in politics is dubious.
And just the Marxist ideology, yeah? So if you control them on that mental level, then
that's true. We'll have to see. Their coalition partner, I think, is pretty anti-EU. Well, we'll just have to wait and see. It's really early in the game. Yeah. What are your? I mean, setting aside the Marxist orientation of them, what do you see in terms of the euro itself going forward?
Well, I think that. I think they will simply pile up the pressure, and you know, the next major crash is going to come in the United States. There's no doubt in my mind about that. Maybe not even so much that it will begin in the United States, but that's the main front for the coming years. And obviously, the fallout for Europe will be huge. But from a global perspective, America will be the main front, and maybe America will get infected via Europe. That's possible, but. Ultimately, something huge in America is going to happen, and this cannot be too far away. I've been expecting it for a long time, many with me, of course. And so I see it as a bit of a sideshow, to be honest, Europe. But for the time being, I still think that the bankers are well in control, although the tensions are enormous. And they are losing the grip on the conversation slowly in many respects. That is clear. More and more people are starting to see, for instance, that you know, the way that Geert Wilders and his buddies all over Europe that they try to frame the mass immigration debate into a anti-Islam debate, for instance, or an outright racist kind of debate. Instead of simply saying we don't want mass immigration, but you know, we're not against immigrants, we're against mass immigration, which is a rational and fully acceptable kind of agenda. But I think more and more people are starting to look for that kind of voice, and it's not really apparent yet, except maybe in France, where you have Dieudonné and his buddy Sorel.
Yeah.
So that would be interesting. But for the time being, they're still pretty much in control, I think.
Well, now is probably a good time to go into the other topic for today, which is your article on the BRICS Bank and kind of the dialectic of moving things to Asia or, you know, outside of the Western control and that. So maybe you could talk about your article for a minute. Any points you want to make about that, and then we'll get into that.
Yeah, the article is about, of course, the BRICS Bank that was opened up last year, and obviously we've been talking about this last time I was on the show also, but there is huge debate about, you know, what's the real deal with this this America-Russia struggle that is going on, and the BRICS Bank, is this anti-New World Order? And obviously the premise of my article is that it's a bank and it's a globalist bank. And there are two flavors of globalism, Western globalism and Eastern globalism, and people can choose between them. And that is what we're facing today, this artificial choice. And a BRICS Bank is a bank, and it's usury, and it's deflation, and it's money scarcity, and it's centralized control, and it's absolutely everything that we want to avoid. Okay, it's not the IMF, but that's the only good thing that you can say about it.
What about the Asia Infrastructure Bank that China is setting up? That's specifically to develop infrastructure at, you know, relatively low interest rates. I mean, it's in other words, it's not a profit-oriented thing. It's to create infrastructure which will basically help China do business around Asia.
Yeah. Well, you know, from a nationalist perspective, that's obviously much better than, you know, borrowing from Goldman Sachs. That must be clear. But on the other hand, such a bank will really further entrench Beijing power, and Beijing will be very much in control of this infrastructure and you know, the direction it will take, and you can rest assured that this control will be used to also very much militarily enforce China and prepare for the big showdown that is coming. And it will do little for common people, although it will create employment. But I think, you know, I think it's not my view of an ideal world that we can become wage slaves for big Chinese corporations to create infrastructure for the Chinese army to put up a big fight when the time comes. Although, you know, we may have good wages for a couple of years, but I have absolutely no faith in the Chinese power structure, and you know, building up China is very much part of the. Let me finish this. The building up China is very much part of the long term agenda of this whole new world order.
Okay, well, I guess my take is I suspect the New World Order banksters in Europe and the U.S. kind of had a different game plan. I think they thought they had control of Russia, and that would give them enough influence over China. But I think that actually the last 15 years or so have not gone their way. And that, I don't know if you want to call them hidden factions, they're now not hidden anymore, but powerful factions in China and Russia are not along with the program. And so I think we're heading into war. And I'm not saying that's good, but I'm saying I don't think they're actually part of the program. I think that they have pretended to be part of the program. Mm-hmm. In other words, Putin has used Medvedev as a front man. The people behind Putin, the nationalistic KGB types, have used Medvedev because he likes Western stuff and he's a lightweight. But I think that actually that's a front. And I think in China you've seen the rise with Xi, the current president. They're fighting the U.S. and the Western assets on every front, practically to the highest level. So I think the influence of the West is there, the banksters, but I don't think it's nearly as much as they thought. And I think they're being resisted very strongly. And so anyway, that's just my take. I may well be wrong, mm-hmm. but that's just how I see it.
Yeah.
And so I see that the banksters overestimated the West, you know, their influence. And that's why we're getting more and more militarized. It's, you know, they were arrogant 30 years ago. They thought they were going to have their New World Order smoothly. Was it Ben-Gurion was in Life magazine in the 1960s, and he was asked, what will life be like 25 years from now? And essentially, there'll be a New World Order. There'll be a world government in Jerusalem. You know what I mean? There are all these things. Mm-hmm. And most of what he thought did happen. Right, the EU and, you know, so on and so forth. But I don't think they quite are getting what they had expected. And so,
no, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, they're clearly behind the gen. No, but, you know, they're clearly behind on their schedule. I mean, I agree with this. And things are not at all going as smoothly as they hoped. And Brzezinski, of course, also has often said stuff saying to that effect. And... But, you know, the reason why I continue to take a critical stance of these things is simply because you do not really see any real populist movement. You see not real political formations that really point at the main and the basic issues. You have a few, maybe you have one in Hungary. You have a populist party there, which is traditionalist and anti-banker. That looks like a pretty good basic layout for what might be coming, but before we see real national, and I'm not really real nationalist, but traditionalist, anti-banker, pro-common man, anti-usury, etc. Until you start seeing that kind of clear-cut populist movement, I am absolutely not optimistic because, for instance, I have absolutely zero faith in secret societies in China that want to further Chinese nationalism, for instance. I can see that they might be troublesome for the New World Order or for the Jews or for whatever, and that they may be a force that will have to be dealt with. But these people also are driven by ambition, and they are not interested in the real interests of Chinese normal people, let alone us here in the West. And what I'm looking for is real political awakening, in the sense that people rise and say, we don't want this backstage politics anymore. We don't want this plutocracy. We don't want to pay taxes and usury and be enslaved with scarce money. Until you see these fundamental things, that will really see a huge increase in living standards for normal people and huge increase in basic economic liberty and in real political representation. Until you see that, it's basically just more of the same. And that's why I also, for instance, have little faith in this Moscow power structure, because, you know, that's also just, okay, Russian elites, but yeah, who cares about Russian elites, you know?
Anthony, do you think that it was just sort of greed and capitalistic forces that offshored all of the American industrial capacity in manufacturing and technological innovations over to China? Or do you think that maybe there is something more nefarious, say a sort of supranational type cabal that doesn't really view themselves as loyal to any one country, that has intentionally shifted the power over in that direction?
Yeah, well, the latter, of course. That's one of the basic premises of my work, and China has been simply built up in a very transparent and well calculated way, and they have simply moved the factories there. And everybody's talking about, oh, the capitalist wants lower wages, but these people are not—they are not driven by short-term profit. They are driven by long-term strategic calculation, and the agenda was simply to build China up. And they are still very much, they would never have brought their factories there if they were not very, very certain that they would be able to control them there.
Right, and this gets back to your point about essentially the elites wanting to take America down, right?
Yeah, very much so, yeah. So the real power base of the United States, which was manufacturing, has been eroded and has been migrated to China. And this is a momentous strategic shift. And yeah, that's, you know, this buildup of China with factories and technology and of course also the trillions of dollars that have been invested there. Yeah, that's, you know, how much clearer does it get?
But Anthony, sure. The other side of it is that the Western elites, or at least the American elites, I mean, they thought that they controlled the financial system and they had the military might. China is still a relatively weak military opponent for the U.S. And so I think they just in their arrogance thought it didn't matter. If you combine corruption, money, power, market size, and then military power, I don't think they had to worry about it. It was their thinking. But I think that they may have misjudged. First of all, I think the Chinese establishment, the Chinese government has done, I think, just a great job in the last 20 years of straightening itself out. And that's a long discussion, but that's one thing. And then Russia has now managed to get herself on her feet, and she does have the military power so that the two of them can protect themselves. And I don't know. It's just my experience is that to the extent I've met people in high places, the arrogance is astronomical.
Yeah, it's unbelievable, Yeah.
And so when you say, how could they do this? They must have calculated. I'm saying, yes, but you're talking about psychopaths calculating here. Arrogant psychopaths who think that they're chosen by God or they're becoming God or whatever these elitists think. So I'm just saying there is that possibility that that's actually what's going on. And put yourself in their shoes 20 years ago. They were looking at China. They were looking at Russia. They some elitist in the city of London must have said, this is a joke. There's no way China or Russia can challenge us. People are starving, you know, in Russia. And in China, it was at that time 90% peasants or something. You know what I mean? It must have seemed like they had it all wrapped up.
Yeah, but, you know, maybe this is a good moment to introduce that war is the goal. Eh? I mean, I think that that they have been... They are creating this this tension, and they have always built up enemies in order to have a good war. And we were talking about a little bit about Saddam Hussein earlier, but he was a typical example of somebody who was built up to create a credible threat who could then be taken down. And okay, he's just a small fry compared to Russia and China, of course, but it's also well known that the Soviet Union was built up with American technology in the 30s and to set the stage for the Cold War and Russian American rivalries to maintain a huge military industrial complex in the United States itself, and that kind of agenda is also behind the buildup of China and Russia nowadays, because Russia also was to at least some extent consciously built up with the high oil prices of the last decade. And yeah, so, you know, they're not afraid of building up enemies to set the stage for conflict and for tension and you know, and they want war as long as they control it anyway.
I might argue that the high oil price empowering China might be sort of an unintended consequence of some of their other agendas.
It's one or the other. Low oil prices help China and high oil prices help Russia. You're going to have to deal with one or the other.
Yeah. But also the high oil prices help their proxies like the Saudis finance their jihadi terror shock troops and so forth.
Yeah, and it was also crucial for the petrodollar, the high oil prices. So that's one of the things that amazed me at this stage with the declining in oil prices, what it will do for the petrodollar in the longer run. But having said that, you know, these guys, they took down Russia in, or the Soviet Union in the 80s with low oil prices. And there's no way that they would have underestimated or miscalculated with the effects of high oil prices on the Russian economy over the longer over the last 10 years. There's absolutely no way that they would have overlooked that. No, that was very much part of the agenda. So they need a strong Russia at this stage for whatever reason, and for the reason that they want to create this tension and this East-West dialectic. And there's also the Rockefellers in China. To get back to China, the Rockefellers have been involved in China for decades. They were very much involved with Mao at the time, for instance, and hailing all the great slaughter of Mao and his consolidation of power in Beijing, etc. And they know they need to get the Chinese on board, and they also know that there is very strong nationalism in China, and that China is not going to just, budge and say, okay, you rule the world and you can rule China also. No, China wants a part of the pie, and they want to be partners in the whole thing. And that is, I think, what to a large extent drives this, for instance, also industrialization of China. There has been a deal made. And the deal is you can modernize and you can be part of the New World Order, and you're the elites there then, not the Chinese people, of course. But I think that is going on. So.
Yeah. Well, but I just don't think they're as powerful as you do. I think they're like parasites, and they kill the host. And so I see a tremendous decline in the West, because we've been under a bankster dictatorship for 100 years or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And but there have been periods where, in different times, in different places in Europe and whatever, they haven't been as strong. And the last mm-hmm. 150 years, it's been particularly bad, getting worse and worse. And now I think they've gotten to the point where, in 15 years, Europe's going to be a museum and a hospice or something. Mm-hmm. Except for rioting immigrants or something. You know what I mean? It's just ridiculous what they've done.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so I think they've got this arrogance. They've got the arrogance of a parasite. but getting back, like you said, for example, they brought down the Soviet Union with oil. But you see, to me, actually, that isn't what they did. What they did is they brought down the Soviet Union by corruption within. They got their agents to the top, like Gorbachev, and they destroyed the country. There are plenty of people, you can talk to people who've worked in the nuclear industry in Russia, and they'll say that the Chernobyl had to have been an explosion. They had to be an inside job. Gorbachev essentially declared war on alcohol. And I forget the numbers, but like 20% of state revenue came from alcohol sales. Can you imagine a government that gets 20% of its revenue outlawing what it gets 20% of its revenue from? I mean, I'm just giving you examples. I'm just saying that you mm-hmm. had mm-hmm. terrorists running the government. Those terrorists were working. It was like putting al-Qaeda in charge, right? Mm-hmm. They destroyed the country. The oil price was secondary. That just made it a lot quicker. And so I don't think that Putin has to worry about the oil price, is what I'm saying. Now, that's grossly exaggerated, because there's the other element of this, is Russian strategy is to pretend weakness all over. And so people mm-hmm. look at Russia, people in the West who mean well look at Russia and say, oh my God, you have all these American Western agents all over the place. And it's like, I'm trying to tell them that, look, at least half of these guys work for the KGB, if not 90%. It's not weakness, it's strategy. These guys are not stupid. So it's just a more complicated mm-hmm. game going on, is what I'm trying to say. But the dialectic, yeah, for sure. There's no question.
Yeah, but the bottom line here is, yeah. Yeah, but that's not really what I'm getting at, Paul. What I'm getting at is that you can have these elites in Moscow, and I'll be the first to admit that they are not buddies with this or that, or that there are very real tensions, and that these power structures have their own purposes, and that they have also the power to vie for their own agenda. That's not really the issue. Because the point is that these competing elites, the distraction is to think, this elite is not the New World Order elite, and therefore it is our friend or something like that. No, these competing elites, they are all driven by the same sort of ambition, power usurpation. They are willing to wage war against each other to forward their own agenda. They are in their own way usurping the national wealth of either Russia or China or whatever. They are in their own way enslaving their own people. And these are not our friends. They don't work for us. They will sacrifice us if we get in their way. And that's the whole thing. And what I see is that all these elites, while competing with each other, are a united front against the peoples of the world. But they, you know, as long as the peoples of the world are not really the problem, then they can fight together. But also, they can create wars between their countries that are actually, in reality, wars by the elites against the nations that are fighting it out in the trenches. And that's my worry, you know. So you can point at Chinese elites that want, you know, independence, or you can Russian elites, but these guys will take us to war, and the real war will be against people like yourself, people like me, people like Russian folks, you know, in Moscow High Street, and that's the whole crux. And there, all these Russian and Chinese elites, I don't care for them, and they are not my friends. They are not our friends. Ultimately, they would like to rule themselves. And that's the whole crux.
Anthony, Gary, this is Gary. I guess you're familiar with an internet personality named Jim Willie.
Yeah, Anthony? Certainly. Yeah, of course. Yeah, yeah, the jackal. Yeah, 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 yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, I know he's something of a gold bug, and, you know, you're opposed to that kind of thing, which I fully understand. But he gave an interview a few days ago, which he went a lot further in claiming some things about the China and the Russia opposition to the West. So I just wanted to kind of play devil's advocate with you a little bit and present some of his claims, and just to get your reaction to them, if that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
So he says that there are some old wealthy families in China that are very upset about what the Western cabal is doing, such as these endless wars, the GMO foods, the chemtrails, the fracking and contamination of water supplies. And he even went so far as to say that they were using HAARP to create a weather modification to cause a drought in China, and that the Chinese were able to disable this. And that the Western cabal is on the extreme defensive against the East. They are afraid of the triad, or that is what Jim Willie calls the Hong Kong Mafia. And he says the Rothschilds and Rockefellers, about 90% of them, have cut deals with the East and agreed to stop a lot of these resource contamination programs, which, you know, I guess the East is supposedly trying to defend the environment because they've got a lot of people to feed. And, well, let's just see, how would you respond to that much so far?
Yeah, okay, but, just look at what they're doing to America, for instance. So America has been really on the decline over the last 50 years or so, and it has been really eaten from within with the GMOs that you just mentioned. I mean, if the bankers wanted to continue rule via the United States, then obviously they would not be poisoning the people with chemotherapy and GMO foods and all the sugar-laced foods and what have you. And societal disintegration. Yeah?
They might be interested in depopulating a good part of the U.S., but, you know, saving a few at the end to do their slave labor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but the thing what must be very clear is that what they're doing to the United States is they're bringing the United States really down in the order of things, and American hegemony is simply very it's threatened simply because the power base of the United States has been really hollowed out. The economy is gutted, the health of the people is gutted, the people are really very demoralized. Fertility of white Americans is way below 2.1, mass immigration from Mexico, blah, 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 blah. Similar story in Europe. So you see a clear decline in the West, and you see Russia and especially China have been on the rise over the last 10 years or so, and 20, 30 years, at least for China anyway. And, you know, American hegemony and American trickery all over the world, and imperialism, and all these wars that you're talking about, and also their this harp stuff that they're up to with the American from the American military. That's all ongoing, and China is and Russia are more and more in a position to resist this from because of their own growing power. But that is what ultimately. This is what they want. This is what they have created. They are building up the East, and they are taking down the West. And ultimately, there must be some showdown, and there must be some sort of migration of real power from the West to the East, if all trends continue as they do. And ultimately, China will take a very large role in the New World Order, in my view then. But this tension that you are referring to is a very natural part of this process and very much by design. And I agree with what you guys are saying, that they're in trouble and that there are problems for them and that things are going much slower than they anticipated, etc. But to point at Chinese resistance against American trickery, that is just, in my view, falling for this basic East versus West dialectic that they're creating.
Okay.
And just look at how people live in China. It's a demoralized population. It's, you know, the one-child policy that they have forced on China is really atrocious and dehumanizing. And people are afraid to speak their mind. And it's also, you know, China is a very nationalistic country. And They would sacrifice easily hundreds of millions of Chinese, just as they would sacrifice 100 million Americans, you know, and that is why they are all the enemy. None of these elites have any good intentions for their own people, for let alone the peoples of competing power structures. And I think that we should start looking at us, the people, and not just the American people, but the Russian people. We are much closer to the Russian people than we are to Russian elites. And Russian elites are much closer to Western elites than they are to the Russian people. And that is what I think that we really need to start to understand. And that's why we really need to disconnect from all these elites. And that's why I keep focusing on who cares whether you pay 5% per year to a Jewish banker or to a Russian banker. Who cares, you know? I mean, you're still paying 5% per year over your mortgage, meaning 150% of the value of your house in usury over 30 years. That's how we are enslaved. And, you know, whether it's a Jewish slaver or a Chinese slaver ultimately will run the world, you know, I couldn't care less. I just want to get rid of all these slavers. And let's find some real populist spirit here. And let's see what we're going to do for the Chinese people, what they are going to do for themselves to rid themselves of these Beijing autocrats, because let's face it, I mean, who wants to be ruled by the Chinese, by the Beijing power structure? I mean, it's a tyranny, it's a despotism.
Yeah, I certainly agree that the money power is what we have to fight at the core of the whole issue.
Mm-hmm.
And if the money power moves from Rockefellers to someone in China, it doesn't really help us that much.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you see as ways that that ordinary folks can undercut the money power and start living their lives apart from it?
Well, you know, in my view, obviously monetary reform is what we all should be aiming for, because, you know, ultimately the most of our life force is taken through usury and related rents and a transnational monopoly that has been built with proceeds of usury. So that's what we all should be aiming at, to get a decent monetary system that will allow workers and entrepreneurs in the economy to maintain control of what they produce themselves, instead of being enslaved by the providers of capital. And you know, that's a larger picture. But yeah, you ask specifically what can ordinary people do, and that's a huge huge question, because obviously the problem with money is that we are dependent on the power of money is how many people use it. So the dollar is used by a lot of people, and that's why it's a strong currency. And before we can even dent such a monopoly, that really sounds like a it's an awe-inspiring task, say. And but I think that starting regional currencies and creating currencies that at least provide alternatives and start building there, and meanwhile agitation against the banks and for reform on the political level, that is, I think, where the real focus should be. And also, from a personal point of view, I think that people really, and this is a challenge for every individual, you know, we have a spiritual challenge, because obviously we are ruled by ego, and that is where we're all at. I mean, everybody suffers from this more or less. And the reason that the money power and all these national elites have managed to rule for so long is simply because we are obsessed with our own little lives and with personal survival, instead of becoming more spiritual people and being able to do with less and focus more on what is necessary in the wider scene.
Yes. Yeah. Well said. Is there anything you think could happen as far as energy or a local food production to get some independence, you know, from the elite systems?
Yeah, I think that, you know, there's been a clear trend for prepping and home gardening and getting off the electricity grid and creating your own energy systems, etc. I think these are all very positive steps, and will definitely also help to get through the depression and improve health, which is very important for on an individual level, of course. And these are all great things, but it's just halfway, and it's also still very centered around, you know, your own kind of survival. And that's my basic problem with prepping and the prepping scene, as we've seen it over the last 10 years or so. It's really all about individual survival, building your own shelter, etc. And it's natural for Western people, because Western people are very individualistically inclined, especially in America. But ultimately, we will have to balance the needs of the community and the needs of individuals, because as an individual, you simply cannot survive, and you are a product of your environment to a large extent. And reaching out to each other and creating systems on a local level, on a smaller level, that allow cooperation and less dependence on larger systems, especially in the monetary sense, but also, you know, you can work together to create local energy, for instance. And you know, this is already ongoing in the United States. Some places in the U.S. you have local people who have managed to create energy solutions that provide local people with energy and allow them to disconnect from transnational oil companies, etc. And yeah, that's all very positive, of course. Yeah, definitely.
And what about the issue of credit? I don't know if you're familiar with the work of Richard C. Cook.
Definitely, yeah.
Yeah, and he's made, you know, a proposal that credit be actually managed as a public utility by the government. And also the national dividend idea also.
Yeah, you know, that's definitely on a larger level, on a national level, what we should be looking at. And that's my proposal also, interest-free credit for normal people. And this can be provided by basically interest-free credit facilities. And the government could easily set this up. And so that would be the basis of monetary reform. And you mentioned credit, and that's really so very important, because many people in monetary reform, they only focus on the money itself. But to have a good grasp of money and a good grasp of the monetary system as a whole, we must really understand that we cannot fully reform money without reforming credit also. And usury is, of course, a function of credit. And usury is the bottom line of the whole thing. And to end usury, we must provide interest-free credit. And so that's solving the monetary issue. And then you were talking about the national dividend. And this should basically be a result of the exploitation of, for instance, common land, common resources. Nowadays, these are all usurped by either the government or transnational corporations and protected by private property laws. But it's, of course, ridiculous that that a few transnational cartels can monopolize oil and arable land and all these things more. It should be understood that these are all part of the commons and that the proceeds of exploiting these parts of the commons should be basically redistributed to the people who own them, and that is the people that live in the land.
Right. And do you see the social credit idea, could that be linked with Ellen Brown's public banking ideas?
Well, you know, not really. And well, I think it's useful to simply have a clear-cut grasp of what these proposals are. What social credit is, social credit would be that the government prints money, debt-free money, and gives it to the people in equal shares, basically a little like a basic income, for instance. And the people then spend the money into circulation. But social credit is a bit of a misnomer because it's actually not credit-based money. It's debt-free money. It's government-printed money, just like the greenback. But then the greenback is spent by the government and the social credit is spent by the people. So therefore, social credit is better because you know, we want decentralization of economic power. So it's better that people have the seigniorage of the money. That's how they call this, the privilege of spending the money when created.
Right.
That's the seigniorage, and this should be with the people. Public banking, on the other hand, is credit-based money because that is just basically fractional reserve banking, but then done by the government. The basic problem with public banking, as it is promoted by Alan Brown, is that it is still interest-bearing. So you would still be paying interest, interest over your mortgage, for instance. This is what I'm very much against. So these are two proposals that I would consider halfway. They have both strong sides, but they are not really comprehensive. They don't solve all our monetary problems. So
I'm just wondering, yeah? You know, if this public banking idea, if people in, say, a state could get together and start a bank that could do, you know, the credit idea, would that be a way to get something going? Because, you know, it's almost impossible at the national level to do anything.
Yeah, well, no, you know, and that's why I like Alan Brown's work, because there is an opportunity basically for everybody in the United States to just open up a bank. And, you know, I'm very much against banking, but obviously you can do banking in, you know, in better and worse ways. And if you do banking well, okay, it would still not be ideal, but it would be at least much, much, much better than what we have now. And, you know, a city like New York should basically open up its own public bank and create its own credit for its own infrastructure projects, for instance. And
right.
This can be done on the state level, on the city level, etc. And it's definitely a huge opportunity, and people should be doing it.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Back to you, Paul.
Okay, well, Anthony, what other things do you see, trends or ideas around the world that you would like to see get more notoriety, so to speak, become more talked about?
Oh. Are there such trends? Yeah, well, you know.
Well, I mean, first of all, you've worked on local currencies, for example.
Yeah, local currencies.
And that's still totally under-discussed, right? There's a discussion about Bitcoin, right?
Yeah.
There's a discussion about bringing back the gold standard, right? Okay, but, you know, that's an example. Local currencies are not discussed.
Yeah.
The currency, Switzerland, right, has that well-known currency, is it?
The Lira, yes.
Yeah. That's hardly known in the United States.
Yeah.
Realize that almost nobody has heard of that in the U.S., just as an example.
Yeah. So just for the listeners here, the VIR is in Switzerland, a huge network of 60,000 corporations that that pay with their own unit, which is based on their own credit. And this has been in operation for 80 years, and they turn over billions per year. And it's a huge add-on for the Swiss economy and has been widely recognized as an important factor in Swiss affluence. So and also has a very strong anti-cyclical effect. So when there is money scarcity due to depression, then the weir is particularly strong and keeps smaller business afloat. And local currencies indeed are a very important part of what we should be looking at, because they're, you know, I've been in the monetary reform now for about 10 years, and from day one I've seen the opportunity that we have here, but I've also seen the downsides, because at this point, you know, the architectures that are out there are not really sufficient. We need more, we need better, and that's one of the things that I've been up to in my own work, to create these superior architectures, and I have my own system nowadays, providing high-class architecture for units that provide everything that you really need in modern money, so interest-free credit, convertible to dollar or euro, both for businesses and consumers. You can pay by phone, and you can pay by online telebanking software, etc. So, you know, really comprehensive units, very cheap, very low cost, low threshold for joining, and I think we have huge opportunities there. And so, yeah, that's definitely what I should, what I would like to see happening more, definitely.
I think another thing is that some people aren't aware of how good the recycling is on the internet now. That is an opportunity for a lot of people. You can grab things for free and turn it into a business. You know, grab furniture, grab different things, clothing, whatever, fix them up and sell them. In other words, you can try to do things locally, but with maybe better technology than we had before.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a lot of little ideas for businesses that, one thing that interests me is kind of underused technology from the past. You know, there are websites with, techniques and technologies from 100 years ago. And it's really quite amazing some of the things that can be done. I'm just saying there's a lot of information out there that people aren't maybe using as much as they could.
So much. I mean, let's face it, Paul. I mean, absolutely. And that's a nice example that you're giving. But let's take this broader view at this, because at the end of the day, we must really very much realize as a people, and this is so very important. You know, people are very afraid of all these problems, etc., but all these problems are totally artificial, and the opportunities that we have as a species to create a society and a living standard for ourselves and each other are just endless. And I think we were discussing this a little bit on the previous show also, but, you know, we have never really learned to imagine how things could be without all these problems, artificial problems that we have nowadays. For instance, our dependence on oil, or this heinous monetary system that we have, and artificial scarcity of money, and therefore artificial scarcity of everything. If we start taking the problems away, all these problems are soluble, and the opportunities that we have, even in very simple ways, things that you were mentioning just yet, low-tech solutions for really big problems. For instance, another nice example is this island of plastic that you have in the Pacific, as big as Texas or something like that, with all plastic bags that have been collected by the ocean there over decades. This can just be just cleaned up with a low-tech solution and low investment. And that's just another nice example of what is really possible. And
Anthony?
Yeah.
I think she's a professor in India who's put together a little small thing to convert plastics, or at least many of them, into petroleum, you know, goo or whatever, with minimal, you know, with like hand power for the third world.
Yeah, fantastic.
And, yeah. I mean, you know, governments could be paying Filipino fishermen to, you know, clean that whole thing up. It really wouldn't cost that much money, but they just don't want to do it. They want the problem.
That's the whole point.
It's the problem reaction solution thing.
Yeah, exactly. And we have been so downcast by this, and so we have become so beaten down by this idea of all these problems and what can you do. But if you start, you know, opening up, when you start seeing how artificial all these problems are, then you also start becoming a fanatical about getting going, you know, because so much is possible, and it's such nonsense that so many people are starving and that our own lives are dominated by, you know, work just to just to keep going. And all this can change and must change, and it will be just such a relief to disconnect from this stupid mainstream life that we're now so accustomed to, and which is causing so much distress in people. And just open up, you know. That's what I would like. If there is a trend that I would like to see more, is just open up and get rid of this stupid life of consumerism and wage slavery. Even now, it's possible.
Yes, it brings up the biggest problem I think we face is not the elites, it's the ignorance of our fellow citizens that's been so brainwashed to think we have to live in scarcity and fear.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's a huge spiritual process, of course, also, because deep down on our egotistical level and in our egotistical self, we fear and we think we cannot belong here, and that we have no right to be, no right to be loved, no right to abundance, and this is the spiritual transformation of once you start realizing who you really are, that you have a spiritual nature, and that the Creator loves us, and you know that this nature, that our natural environment, is really implicitly very abundant, and that we can tap into this. Yeah, that's the great transformation that we're going through.
Unfortunately, I see religions as contributing to the fear meme, because they try to guilt trip everybody, and they try to make you think that suffering is holy. So if you're deprived, then that's just your lot in life. Yeah. And you have to endure it until you get to heaven, you know.
It's absolutely. Just,
it's part of the memes, and it's not helpful.
No, you know, I talk specifically about spiritual matters, because I'm absolutely no friend of religion, and obviously religion is a huge part of the control grid, and actually aimed at avoiding that we find out that we are spirits, and promising a better afterlife. But how about this life? I need salvation now, you know? So
That's 10%, Anthony, 10%.
What?
If you give us 10% of your income.
Yeah.
It's exactly. Called tithing.
Exactly. Yeah, then you'll be saved.
Then you go to heaven. Yeah. And by the way, we also sell indulgences.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? And you
so
know,
forget about religion. That's
for $100,000, we'll forgive you for a bad marriage, or for, you know, whatever, a child out of wedlock, that kind of thing. But that's $100,000 or euros in Europe. But you know what I mean? They really have a racket.
Total racket. And, you know, like I said, I'm a friend of religion, but I'm definitely very spiritually inclined, because ultimately we can talk about the things in the world. But the fact is that we live from ego, and that is the fundamental issue of the human condition. And we need to reconnect to our spiritual, to our true spiritual nature. And that is also ultimately, obviously, at the foundation of all religion, and that is what we really need to, and that is what the New World Order wants to prevent. That's what they fear most, that we realize that we are basically infinite consciousness and infinite energy, and children of God Himself.
Amen to that.
Yeah. Of course. Hey, I got a question for you. So you're in Europe. What is the TV in Europe now? I mean, are you familiar with American TV? When I visit America, I feel like I'm in a zombie land or something.
Yeah.
Whenever I'm near a TV set, the news has become, I don't even know how to describe it. It's psychotic.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's like designed to provoke all kinds of weird emotions, but obviously fear. But it also overwhelms your senses. It's got all these wild colors flashing and movement and everything now. It's really something else. Is it like that in Europe?
Absolutely. Yeah.
No surprise. Yeah. Same owners, right?
Same owners. And we have all these American shows, you know, they're all shown here. And it's all total garbage. You know, I tossed out the TV 10 years ago, so I really see hardly any TV. It's months that I've seen any TV, and I never watch more than maybe half a minute at somebody else's place. But, you know, it's just totally disgusting and totally desensitizing, and that's what it's supposed to do.
Yes, and you know what? We were talking a minute ago about things that people could do to basically destroy the New World Order.
Mm-hmm.
Well, throwing away the TV set is probably just about the highest on the list, to be honest.
Absolutely. Best control mechanism there is.
That's more powerful than TV, than churches today in the United States.
Yeah.
I mean, if you could throw all the churches away, or you could throw away the TV set, which would make the country better?
Yeah.
You know, the churches are a problem. There's no question. But I'm just saying that the TV set is this. I mean, you run into it. You run into people who practically worship it. They live by it. They can't sleep without the TV on, even.
Yeah. Yeah, it's disgusting. Like I said, I tossed it out 10 years ago because it's just too horrible. And it's the same with the newspapers, etc. You know, that's also a clear trend, the disconnect between, the things that we are discussing here today and the kind of garbage that the media are promoting and showing. And yeah, something's got to give at some point. It's not really sustainable anymore, because more and more people are just realizing it's too gross, too dehumanizing, really, too stupid and too out of touch what the media are showing.
I'm kind of optimistic, to be honest. I think that the system's going to break.
Me too.
I think that's part of the reason they're setting up wars and all that. I don't think it's just for some dialectic. I think that if you get to the point where, let's say, 10% of the people wake up, in other words, if you go from 1% to 10%, I think it'll break their system. So I think they have to be prepared to create a huge economic collapse or war.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm actually optimistic. I'm optimistic about it.
Well, I'm optimistic about the awakening that is going on. Not even so much the internet awakening, but the real spiritual awakening that I see happening with more and more people. And so I'm very optimistic about that. And like you said, they need the war and the crises to traumatize humanity back into its cage. And it's more and more difficult for them to get away with this, because you saw it in Syria, there was absolutely no support for that carnage that they had intended there. And it's also happening in the Ukraine. For instance, in the aftermath of the MH17 crash in the Ukraine, I'm here in Holland, so that was a Dutch plane. And the warmongering of the mainstream media in the aftermath of that crash was really actually very terrifying. But within weeks, you would see in the first few days, you'd see people being in shock and these bloody Russians and this and that. But only weeks later, you would see that really mainstream people were just hammering the mainstream media on their own outlets with comments like, "Well, Putin at least knows what he's doing," and these assholes here in the our politicians, they're just full of crap and etc., etc. And that was really, that was really inspiring. And people, and I also see it with the resisting against mass immigration, which is really mounting. But simultaneously, you see that people don't fall for the crap of Muslim terrorists were behind Paris, for instance. They don't fall for it. The worst, they will say things like, okay, even if it is a Muslim, you can't blame all Muslims for this, And this kind of basic humanness, this kind of basic faith in other people, that is really a great thing to behold. And it's becoming more and more difficult for them to disunite people with crap like that.
Yeah, I think so too. I think humanism of the right kind could kind of kill their agenda. I mean, that's all they know how to do, is fear war and all that destruction. Because again, it's not like they're very good at creating things.
Exactly.
Well, Anthony, why don't we wrap it up, unless you've got any last comments you'd like to...
No, I think that'll be about it. It was 2 hours already, so...
Yeah, we're getting wearing you out. And your website again?
Realcurrencies.wordpress.com for all the ins and outs on monetary reform and what can be done about the banks. So.
Well, the real thing is usury, usury, usury.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the bottom line, and that's what drives everything. Yes.
Okay, well, thanks again for coming. We do appreciate it. It's a wrap, folks.
Thanks so much for having me on.
Yeah, thank you, Anthony.
Okay, thanks, guys.
Okay, bye-bye.